You know, when we think about it, we live in a pretty amazing time these days. Just a few minutes ago, I got off a Zoom call where we were gathered as the Tennessee Conference Council on Finance and Administration to talk about an issue we needed to deal with. And we had people that called in from Memphis and Jackson and Murfreesboro and Cookeville and even Green Hills and Madison. We were able to see one another and talk to one another and come to a common consensus about an issue that we needed to deal with. See, we through the internet were connected. We were able to work together in a particular way to make something happen. And part of the genius of John Wesley was his recognition that being connected is really important. And it's important for the church to be connected not only to the members inside a congregation, but to other congregations as well, that we come together and are able to work together through our connection. What Wesley understood is really the power of synergy, the notion that the output of the whole or an output of a group is more powerful than that of just the individuals on their own. And so today we're going to talk about the United Methodist Church as a connectional church. And I'm going to make the argument that connectionalism is the way church should be and that it is a very, very good thing. This is Prime Worship. I'm Jay Voorhees, pastor of the City Road Chapel, United Methodist Church, and the Lord be with you.
This is Prime, the online service of prayer and praise for and from the City Road Chapel United Methodist Church, located in Madison, Tennessee. This service is for September the 20th, 2020, during the season of Ordinary Time.
Let us pray together. Lord of life and light, you brought together all sorts of different people to proclaim your name and offer healing to the world. As we gather today, help us to hear our calling to do likewise. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is his new creation, my water and the word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. Elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth. Her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth. One holy name she blesses, partakes one holy food. And to one hope she presses, with every grace endued. Yet she on earth hath union with God the three in one, and mystic sweet communion with those whose rest is won. Oh, happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them the meek and lowly, on high may dwell with thee.
Hello. Our act of praise today is adapted from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. We invite you to join in this prayer of affirmation. Almighty God, we ask for your grace as we try to live as people worthy of the calling you gave us. May we be humble, gentle in spirit, and patient. Remind us daily to accept each other with love and make every effort to preserve the unity of the Spirit with the peace that ties you together. May we never forget that we are one body and one Spirit, just as you also called us in one hope. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and one God and Father of all, who is over all, through all, and in all.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Welcome to City Road Chapel, a church in the United Methodist tradition located in Madison, Tennessee. For over 170 years, people have gathered in this area to worship, study, and serve their neighbors. We are deeply rooted in this community and are committed to proclaiming God's love to all of our neighbors, no matter their background or situation. During the COVID outbreak, we have suspended in-person worship to keep everyone safe. Our ministry in Madison includes caring for children and assisting families through our Child Development Center, and offering help to the impoverished through a variety of ministries. We believe that we are called to both grow in our love of God and to love our neighbors as Christ loved us. Our ministry is dependent on the generosity of our members and the community. If you would like to make a donation to the work of City Road Chapel, please visit our website at cityroadchapel.org/give. All donations are tax deductible. We hope and pray that you find meaning in today's service, and we hope that you will continue to join us online or join us at our Sunday worship service very soon. Our scripture for today is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 12, verses 1 through 17. So, brothers and sisters, because of God's mercies, I encourage you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice that is holy and pleasing to God. This is your appropriate priestly service. Don't be conformed to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you can figure out what God's will is, what is good and pleasing and mature. Because of the grace that God gave me, I can say to each one of you, don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. Instead, be reasonable, since God has measured out a portion of faith to each one of you. We have many parts in one body, but the parts don't all have the same function. In the same way, though there are many of us, we are one body in Christ, and individually we belong to each other. We have different gifts that are consistent with God's grace that has been given to you. If your gift is prophecy, you should prophesy in proportion to your faith. If your gift is service, devote yourself to serving. If your gift is teaching, devote yourself to teaching. If your gift is encouragement, devote yourself to encouraging. The one giving should do it with no strings attached. The leader should lead with passion. The one showing mercy should be cheerful. Love should be shown without pretending. Hate evil and hold on to what is good. Love each other like the members of your family. Be the best at showing honor to each other. Don't hesitate to be enthusiastic. Be on fire in the Spirit as you serve the Lord. Be happy in your hope. Stand your ground when you're in trouble and devote yourselves to prayer. Contribute to the needs of God's people and welcome strangers into your home. Bless people who harass you. Bless and don't curse them. Be happy with those who are happy, and cry with those who are crying.
Consider everyone as equal, and don't think that you're better than anyone else. Instead, associate with people who have no status. Don't think that you're so smart. Don't pay back anyone for their evil actions with evil actions, but show respect for what everyone else believes is good. As you reflect on this passage, consider the following questions. Is faith in Jesus primarily an individual activity, or does it involve the broader community of faith? What part do you play in Christ's body, and how are you connected to the rest of the body? How are you presenting yourself as a holy and living sacrifice to God?
So today we're taking some time to talk about what it means to be people of connection, or to be a connectional church, as we like to say in the United Methodist Church. And some of that has to do with our polity, the way that we're organized, our organizational structure. But I want to argue that connectionalism needs to be a part of our core mission and identity as United Methodists. And this came to me a few years ago. The Council of Bishops of the Methodist Church did this big study on church vitality. They called it Vital Congregations. And they looked at churches that were growing and healthy and successful and said, well, what are these churches doing to make that happen? And they offered several prescriptions of things that churches needed to think about doing. But it was in their appendix, kind of hidden in the back, where they described church vitality in a way that really sort of changed my understanding of ministry. They said that vital churches, or church vitality, is the dynamic state of engagement in which people are connected to God, connected to one another, and connected to the world in profound ways. And that really started me thinking about our core mission is about the work of connection. Now, we say we are a church that makes disciples for the transformation of the world, and I agree with that. But the way that we do that is by helping people connect. First of all, connect to the divine, to God. And I think that's why all of us are involved in church, or we're on a spiritual journey. We want to connect with the God that created us and loves us. We're looking for something, and something in the metaphysical reality. And so we are definitely wanting to connect to God. And the church's role is to help facilitate that connection. And then we are called to facilitate the connection to one another. And that goes hand in hand with our connection to God. Because how do we know more about God? It's through relationships with others. And as we connect, as we move into a deeper connection with God, we also more deeply connect with our neighbors. And so, as a church, our job is to facilitate connections to God and connections to one another, but then also connections to the needs of the world. For we understand as a church that we are interconnected with everyone throughout the world, that we are all created in the image of God, that we all are of sacred worth, and that we all are deeply connected to one another. And so part of our work in mission is to help us understand what the entire world is going through and how our faith then impacts what happens in the world. The sociologist Brené Brown said that humans were created for connection. And the work of the church, I think, is to facilitate that connection. I think the need to focus on connection is really important in our world today because we live in a world, particularly in Western culture, that really lifts up individualism as the guiding focus for our life. There are all sorts of sources and all sorts of reasons why individualism has become so important in our world today. But we really need to just understand that within the Christian context, individualism kind of falls outside of the vision offered by the early church and by the early Christians, even by Jesus. Instead, many folks look to philosophers like Ayn Rand. Ayn Rand said wrote in one of her books that, "And now I see the face of God. I raise this God over the earth, this God whom men have sought since men came into being, this God who will grant them joy and peace and pride." And that sounds all wonderful until she says who this God is. This God is I. See, what she's suggesting is that the most important thing is that we focus on ourselves, that our purpose in life, the way that we will be successful in the world, is to focus primarily inward on ourselves. That really goes back to the original sin story of Adam and Eve. For in that story about where sin came into the world, where we were separated with God, their disobedience wasn't so much about, or the problem wasn't so much about eating the fruit. It was about their desire to be their own gods, to be like God. And humanity, from the beginning of time, has always struggled against this desire to want to be in control, to want to be our own gods, to think that we can go alone, that we don't need help, that we are not interconnected. Honestly, our church structures even reflect this. Now, we in the Methodist Church have what we call a connectional structure, where we are interconnected. There is this web, this network of connectedness through pastors and leaders and churches. But most of the churches around us, certainly most of the Protestant churches, have what they call a congregational model of leadership. That is, that the congregation themselves determines everything that happens in the church. And there is no, even though there might be some loose connections to other groups, they are in control of their own destiny and don't have any relationship, direct relationship, to those other churches. We believe as United Methodists that there's an importance in an individualistic world to be able to say, hey, we are really interconnected with one another. And that is really the vision that's presented in the scriptures. The vision that's given by Jesus is of a world in which his followers, a kingdom in which we all understand that we are interconnected with one another. I think that the vision of Jesus and the vision of the scriptures was an understanding that we are all connected to one another, that we are joined with one another through our creation by God and just through the love that we're called to practice with one another. Jesus, I think, says it very clearly in John 17 when he's praying for his body, for his followers to be one. He understands that they're supposed to be unified. And Paul, all throughout all of his writings, really focuses on the unity of the body of Christ. Now, I know that seems weird in a context where we have denominations and Christ's body is really pretty splintered. And I think that really is part of the brokenness of our human condition. And yet, I also think our goal must always be towards understanding ourselves as connected with other folks, that we are interconnected with one another. Paul reminds us that in Romans 12, which we read earlier, that we aren't supposed to think more highly of ourselves than we should think. It's not to say we shouldn't think of ourselves as beloved children of God and that we shouldn't have good esteem and all of those kinds of things. But it is saying we shouldn't think of ourselves as more important than the other guy, because we are connected to the other guy. And he lays that out as he describes the body of Christ. He says, we have many parts in one body. And he recognizes the parts don't have the same function. I'm not the same as someone down the street, or I have different roles and different ways of understanding and different connections to God. But that doesn't remove my connection to them. Even though we think differently, maybe we pray differently, we are still interconnected to one another and are working together to build up Christ's body, Christ's church in the world, to make Christ's vision of the world come into purpose, come into to being. Now, I really love what Paul says later on, because he kind of gives a vision of what this looks like. He says, love should be shown without pretending, hate evil, hold on to what is good, love each other like members of your family. Be the best at showing honor to each other. Now, we all understand our families as connected, even when we have black sheep in our families. You know, people that we don't want to be connected to, we still are connected whether we want to be or not. And Paul understands that part of our purpose in humanity is to understand ourselves as connected to one another. And so all throughout Romans 12, he gives these ideas of how you go ahead and practice that. Practices that sometimes have been lost in the world today. I really like the way that Martin Luther King Jr. says it. I have this quote, by the way, on the wall of my office. I've had it for a while. And he says that all life is interrelated. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. As long as there's poverty in the world, no man can be totally rich, even if he has $1 billion. As long as diseases are rampant and millions of people cannot expect to live more than 20 or 30 years, no person can be totally healthy, even if he just got a clean bill of health from the finest clinic in America. Strangely enough, I can never be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be. This is the way the world is made, King says. I didn't make it that way, but it's the interrelated structure of reality. What King understands, what the Bible reflects, is that we are interconnected with one another, and there's nothing we can do to change that. And so while we fight all the time to proclaim our individualism, our individuality, the reality is we need one another. Back as Brené Brown said, we are created for connection, and our job as Christ's people is to facilitate that connection. So it's important for us to remember that we are interconnected with one another. And particularly in a world that really wants to lift up our individualism and individuality, it's important for us to proclaim that we think being connected is important. That's what our structure as United Methodists does. It's a prophetic witness, I believe, when we're carrying it out, and I want to honestly say that sometimes we don't live it out, but when we're living it out, it's a prophetic witness to an individualistic world saying that interconnection is important, that we've been created to love one another and to be connected to one another. And in spite of all of our best efforts to ignore that or to cast that aside, the reality is that God's love says we are created to be connected, and there's nothing we can do to change that. As you go through your week this week, I hope that you'll be thinking about, how am I interconnected to someone else? How is my life affected by someone else's life? And how does my impact on the world change somebody else's life down the road? See, we are not just on our own. God didn't create us that way. God created us to be connected. May the Lord bless and keep you this week.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above. Before our Father's throne, we our hopes, our aims are one, our comforts and our cares. We share each other's woes, our mutual
Jesus inward pain, but we shall still be joined in heart and hope to meet again.
So it's time to finish up our service. I have a couple of announcements to share with you today. First of all, just a reminder that on the 27th, we will be doing our Feast Community Meal to Go, as we've done the past few months. We always like to have folks come help stuff bags and hand out meals. So if you're available and want to come help, show up about 4 o'clock on Sunday the 27th, and we will put you to work. I also want to take a moment of personal privilege to thank Quinn Moore for all of his efforts related to the community meal. For many, many years now, Quinn has been our chef for that meal and has done an excellent job making sure that folks are fed. He's going to take a little time off from that, a retirement from that, and I just want to thank you, Quinn, for everything that you've done to make the community meal a success. We also continue with our showers of blessing, laundry, and shower trailer, which is on the property on Mondays and Wednesdays. If you are available to volunteer with that, we are looking for folks to serve in that way as well. And don't forget our Walk in the Way podcast. Walking in the Way is a podcast read-through we're doing of the Gospel of Mark. You can find it on our church website or subscribe in your podcast software. It's really just a little 7-minute weekly reflection on the story of Jesus, and I hope that you all will come participate in that. So now it's time to move into our prayer time. Take a moment to review the situations that we're aware of at this moment as they scroll by on our screen. Let us pray. God of creation, you have brought us together for a purpose. We sometimes think that we are a random group of individuals, but your desire is that we be one body, joined together in love. Help us to never forget that calling, and deepen our connections to you, one another, and the world, so that both we and the world will be changed. Lord, we recognize that our world today is in turmoil. There is great division regarding what the world should look like. We are seeing the effects of human activity in the environment. The west coast of our nation is on fire, while the southern coast is inundated with water. And all around us are sickness, hunger, and despair. And in the midst of all of this, Lord, it's easy to give up hope. Yet we know your hope is never ceasing, and that part of our job is to be people proclaiming hope. Don't let us fail in that proclamation, and help us to not live in fear, but in the certainty of your love and grace. Jesus, we bring all these petitions before you, remembering that you took the form of a servant, humbling yourself to the point of death, so that all the world might be redeemed and light would shine in the darkness. It's in your honor that we pray together the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
May God hold you in the palm.